I welcome you to our summer service here at St. Luke's United Church. And I thank Marion for playing for us that wonderful song, What a Wonderful World. I know that at this time when we're not able to meet in our church in person, we are able to share some time with you, and I'm glad that we're able to do this. And I thank Andrew Schneider for recording this service for us so that we can share it with you. Just a couple of announcements. I know that the summer banners have all been delivered, and so hopefully you have a banner with you that you can check out all the important information on various fronts having to do with our church life. And if for some reason you didn't get a banner and you would like to receive one, please call the church office and leave a message and let them know, and we'll get one to you as quickly as possible. Also, just a note, if there are any pastoral care needs that you have, or if you know someone who is in need of support, please contact me personally. My name is Daria, if you don't know already. Or you can phone the church office or email the church and let them know as well. Phone messages and emails at the office are checked regularly, so if you have any concerns about anything, please don't hesitate to contact us. As we begin our time here, we acknowledge that our church is situated on the Haldimand Tract, 6 miles on either side of the Grand River, traditional territory of the Neutral, Anishinaabe, and Haudenosaunee peoples. May we live, work, and worship in right relations with this land and its peoples. During this time when meeting in our own church building has not been possible, we know that our congregants have had other opportunities to share in worship, either through weekly televised services from the wider community or through online connections with our friends at Trillium United here in Cambridge. No matter how or where we meet as one in Christ. And so I will light the Christ candle. And as we do that, I'll invite you to sing verse 1 of Holy, Holy, Holy. I would invite you to join me in a time of prayer. Let us pray. Eternal and Holy Spirit, on this warm and sunny summer day, it is good that we come together as we are able, joining in community, enabled by technology that was developed with brain power given by you, O God. We come with humility and thanksgiving for your awesome gifts of life and love. Though we cannot be together in close proximity to one another, and we join from unique situations, I pray that each one of us will be able to leave behind the craziness of our world for this time and space. As we offer our prayers, share songs of hope, hear sacred stories, and try to make sense of our lives in these challenging times, help us to feel the comforting presence of your Holy Spirit that binds us all as one in love. And I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. There is an old proverb that speaks of light in the soul bringing beauty in the person, and harmony in the house bringing order in the nation, all leading to peace in the world. Science tells us that light is perhaps the only true constant in the universe, and as children of God, we see that constant as light of the soul, helping us to recognize the real beauty in ourselves and our neighbor, which in turn resolves dissonance and produces harmony in our communities. I believe that this radiates outward to encourage order within our nation, ultimately working for peace with our global siblings. And as Yoko Ono and John Lennon put it in their song, Imagine, they said, "So the world will live as one." As Christians, we believe that Jesus' example can really help us to achieve that goal of good global warming, a world warmed by God's love. In his teachings, Jesus encourages that connection to God where our soul will feel at home and at peace. If you are with someone else as you watch this service, I invite you to share a sign of peace. And I say to each of you, may the peace of Christ be with you. I'll invite you to join in singing a hymn about that wonderful peace. We'll sing, "Make Me a Channel of Your Peace." Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, found in the fifth chapter, reading beginning at verse 14. And I've included the reading so that you can follow along. Paul writes, "Our firm decision is to work from this focused center. One man died for everyone. That puts everyone in the same boat. He included everyone in his death so that everyone could also be included in his life. A resurrection life, a far better life than people ever lived on their own. Because of this decision, we don't evaluate people by what they have or how they look. We looked at the Messiah that way once and got it all wrong, as you know. We certainly don't look at him that way anymore. Now we look inside, and what we see is that anyone united with the Messiah gets a fresh start, is created new. The old life is gone. A new life burgeons. Look at it. All this comes from the God who settled the relationship between us and him, and then called us to settle our relationships with each other. God put the world square with himself through the Messiah, giving the world a fresh start by offering forgiveness of sins. Now God has given us the task of telling everyone what he's doing. We are Christ's representatives. God uses us to persuade men and women to drop their differences and enter into God's work of making things right between them. We're speaking for Christ himself now. Become friends with God. He's already a friend with you." In Paul's second letter, During this time when churches suspending in-person worship, as I mentioned before, some of our people have been joining together with Trillium United for online worship and Bible study. And in those services, Reverend Mark Rutledge and other worship leaders are focusing on jargon words. Essentially, common words of our faith that we throw around on a regular basis. Words like sin, repentance, forgiveness, faith, grace, gospel, righteousness, holiness, and salvation. Today we'll look at these words and we'll see how they relate to our life journey and strengthen our relationship with our Creator. Over the past couple of decades, authors have been adopting the practice of naming their novels with one-word titles. So I can imagine that someone might put out a trilogy of books using our first three jargon words as titles: sin, repentance, forgiveness. I can also imagine that the author of such a series could approach these words and subjects from various perspectives and no doubt draw some attention and possible controversy, depending on their treatment of the subjects. These three, sin, repentance, and forgiveness, are related, as I see it, flowing from one another in what I think seems to be a series of sorts. Speaking of the first of the trilogy, sin, we could go on at great length, itemizing what type of activities could fall under the heading of sin, but I'm not going to be going down that road today. I invite you to consider a couple of things. The dictionary says that sin is the transgression of divine law or principles of morality. You've probably also heard the idea of sin being anything that separates us from God. Attitudes we have, actions we take, and associations that we maintain. In the Christian scriptures, we read about John the Baptist preparing the way for the coming of Christ and preaching the importance of repentance. We believe that God is love, and so it follows that anything separating us from God also separates us from love. The perfect kind of love that we aspire to share, guiding and supporting us in our daily interactions with others. John the Baptist encouraged people of his time to turn away from those attitudes, actions, and associations with things that would separate them from the loving way God would have them live. Then Jesus carried John's message a step further, that by turning back to God, we will be forgiven. By turning back to God, repenting, we are given a second, third, or perhaps 50th chance at a new life, a chance to begin again. As Paul said in his letter to the Corinthians, Jesus taking on the burden of our transgressions is God's way of giving the whole world a fresh start through the forgiveness of sins. Is it always easy for us to accept that forgiveness from God? Intellectually, I think we hear the words, but sometimes our hearts just can't let go of that which keeps us down and under the thumb of unhappiness, separated from God's love. Twyla Paris wrote a song called Hold On, and I want you to share with you just a small portion of the lyrics with you today. The chorus goes like this: You can hold on to sorrow and hold on to pain. You can hold on to anger when there is nothing to be gained. You can hold to a thread at the end of a rope, but if you hold on to Jesus, you are holding on to hope. Hold on. The hope that Jesus gives is demonstrated by his message of God's forgiveness to us. Jesus' message of God's love for us is not just for those times when we're feeling like we're on the right track and living exactly as God wants us to. God's love and forgiveness is there for us no matter what, during times of doubt and despair, faltering and failing. God's faithfulness to us is never ending. And because of God's faithfulness to us, we can learn to trust and have faith, the next word we look at, in return for that faithfulness to us. It's not always easy to trust in things unseen. But in my experience, there have been too many times when the presence of a higher power or intelligence seems evident. When I have felt that proverbial tap on the shoulder or perhaps a little whisper in my ear to call someone or take something along because I might just need it. There have been many times that I have chosen not to heed that little nudge and I've regretted it. Our secular world may say that you cannot prove the existence of divine intervention, but I would reply and say that it cannot be disproved either. And that's where our faith kicks in. I would like to share with you some music. Marion and I will share it. It's a piece called He's always been faithful to me. And it incorporates the hymn, the wonderful hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. And so I will invite you to join in singing with me when the time comes.
Oh, God's loving compassion, it knows no end. All I have need of, God's hand will provide. God's always been faithful to me. God's always been
so many blessings. We just sang, "Wondrous the portion thy blessings provide, and all I have needed thy hand has provided." Indeed, we have been blessed greatly, and so we are given the opportunity to give back to God a portion of those blessings. Your prayers for our congregation are always welcome. And even though our church building is not open for worship and other activities, there are still expenses that need to be met. I encourage you, if you are able, and thank you for your support of St. Luke's Church during this time. There are various ways to support our church financially, and we show it up on the screen. You could mail us a check to the church. You could, if you aren't already signed up for pre-authorized remittance, or PAR, for regular withdrawals from your bank account, you could let us know if you would like to do that, or you can contact Peter McKellar directly. You could use the church's email address at stlukesunited@gmail.com to send us an e-transfer. And also on our website, you can click on the donate button. And so we offer our gifts to God and give thanks for all that people do and give. Many of Paul's letters had the purpose of encouraging the people in the early church. He encouraged them to grow their faith, reinforcing the beliefs of the early Christians. In the section that I read earlier, Paul touches on many aspects and concerns, and indeed, in those few paragraphs, he addresses the rest of the jargon words that we are considering today. Paul says that God settled the relationship between us and him, which means that Jesus was sent to achieve that settlement, that Jesus has facilitated our relationship with God, and through his death has brought forgiveness for our sins, that separation that we spoke of from our Creator. Paul continues by saying that God has then called us to settle our relationships with each other. In other words, because we have been forgiven, how can we not forgive others when we feel that we have been wronged? If only in thanksgiving for God's unfailing love for us. We know it's not easy to forgive sometimes. Wounds go very deep, whether they are physical wounds, emotional wounds, spiritual wounds. Some go very deep and last a lifetime, or perhaps generations over the generations. No one is perfect, and I believe that God wants us to try our best to live in right relations with all that we come in contact with. God's gift to us in Jesus, and God's continuing forgiveness comes through grace. And because of that, we are compelled to live as righteously as we can, to show others what joy God can bring into our lives. We acknowledge Jesus' holiness, but also take comfort in his humanity, for he knows what we go through in times of trial or tribulations. Paul says that God has given us the task of telling everyone what he is doing. We are Christ's representatives. I believe that we can do this because Jesus showed us what is possible while he was with us on earth. We have become God's hands, God's tongues, commissioned to spread the good news of the gospel, helping to persuade men and women to drop their differences, as Paul says, and enter into God's work of making things right between us and those around us. Paul said, we're speaking for Christ now, for Christ himself. We are given the opportunity and indeed called to multiply the Christ, as Reverend Mark says, and do what Christ would do. And I believe that when we engage in this work of sharing God's love, there is joy in our hearts and our souls will feel at home. May we be encouraged to live out our callings, whatever they may be, so that God can work through each and every one of us. Amen. I'll invite you now to join with me in singing in Voices United, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore You. I invite you to join me in a time of prayer. Loving Holy Presence, God of our understanding, Each one of us comes today with our own feelings and thoughts, joys and sorrows, celebrations and hurts. Collectively, we join together our hearts and minds to give you thanks and praise for all the blessings we enjoy, all the ways that our lives are enriched by the goodwill of others. For we believe that all kindness, all compassion, all good things, no matter how small or insignificant they may seem, they are rooted in your perfect love. At a time in our lives like this, God, when rules and restrictions have limited our actions and freedoms for the common good, it seems that it might go on forever. That waiting in line just to get into the grocery store might become our new normal. When wait times for medical procedures seem to get longer and our patience is tried, in all those times we wait on you, O God. Our souls wait for patience and strength. There are times when we don't understand why people suffer as they do, or why people aren't more tolerant and understanding of each other. Sometimes we spend more time focusing on our own problems, and we may find ourselves getting stuck in feelings of hopelessness or guilt. We wait for you, O God. Our souls wait for your forgiveness and your redeeming power. There are times, compassionate God, that we or those we love are overcome with feelings of sadness or loneliness. Times when loss puts up even more barriers in our lives, whether it be the loss of loved ones, loss of employment, loss of relationships or loss of dignity, loss of health, God, gives us cause for so much pain. We wait for you, God. Our souls wait for your comfort and your assurance that we do not travel through the dark valleys alone. We pray for all those who are dear to us, who are going through difficult times. There are some prayers that cannot find the right words and remain in our heart. We wait for you, O God. Our souls wait for your understanding and your ability to see the healing we need. May we recognize your support and be thankful. And joining together as we are comfortable, we offer up our words in song that Jesus taught us as we sing the Lord's Prayer.
Kingdom come, thy will be done on
Our final hymn that we'll share today is one that gives us the assurance of God's love no matter what is going on in our lives, no matter what we're thinking, no matter how we're acting. Let us sing together, Blessed Assurance. Thank you for taking the time to share in this time of worship with us. And I thank Marion very much for coming out of the summer break time, and Andrew as well, for making this possible. Thank you very much. And now, may God give us courage to accept the forgiveness offered to us and pass on that grace and acceptance to others. May the grace of God, the peace of Christ, and the comfort of the Holy Spirit be with each one of us now and always. Amen. I'll invite you to join in singing, Go Now in Peace.